Hello, I'm Simon Whistler. You're watching Today I Found Out, and in the video today, we're looking at that time Coca-Cola tried to introduce vending machines that charged more on hot days. Just before we get started, I do want to say that this video is made possible by Cheddar. You might know Cheddar from their live news network or cool product reviews on Facebook, but now they are making weekly YouTube videos. And if you like Today I Found Out, you'll also like their videos. Check them out through the link in the description below, and let's get started. If Coca-Cola's own marketing is to be believed, few things are more satisfying than a cold drink on a hot day. Now, Coca-Cola made a number of serious missteps in the late 20th century, and this was one of them. For the others, you should definitely see our videos. That time Coca-Cola spent $100 million intentionally filling Coke cans with water that smelled like farts. That time Coca-Cola tried to sell bottled tap water in the UK and the hilarity that ensued. And that time Coca-Cola decided to stop making their best-selling product, Coca-Cola. Now, the company reportedly tried to take advantage of sweltering days, making their product more desirable, by attempting to introduce vending machines that would charge more the hotter it was outside. The genesis of this story can be traced back to an otherwise mundane interview given by the short-lived and wildly unsuccessful Coca-Cola CEO Doug Ivester in 1999 to the Brazilian magazine Veja. During the interview, Ivester opined that Coca-Cola is a product whose utility varies from moment to moment. He sagely explained that demand for ice-cold Coca-Cola spiked during especially hot weather and during certain events. Ivester then reasoned that, in such a situation, it is fair Coca-Cola should be more expensive, while no doubt simultaneously devouring his own foot and grabbing a shovel and digging himself into a giant hole. When asked how Coca-Cola as a company plans to take advantage of the amazing revelation that hot weather inexplicably also coincided with an increased demand for cold drinks, Ivester stated that they'd been developing a new line of vending machine that exploited this fact. Specifically, Ivester explained that Coca-Cola had been experimenting with vending machines that contained a thermostat and simple software that would raise the price of the products within the machine once a certain temperature threshold had been reached. As Ivester himself would correctly point out during the interview, neither the technology nor the idea of raising the price of a product in times of great demand was a new concept, noting in regards to the latter that the machine will simply make this process automatic. Early media reactions to Ivester's comments were relatively muted. The New York Times, for example, mused that the idea was merely a natural extension of the concept of supply and demand, and that the advent of affordable computer chips could make the endeavor impossibly lucrative if handled correctly. The paper also pointed out that while, yes, the concept might seem unfair to a thirsty person, variable pricing had already been the norm for other industries, most notably airlines, for many years at this point. Indeed, such variable pricing can be seen when we buy from restaurants, car dealerships, power companies, hotels, grocery and clothing stores, online retailers such as Amazon, etc. Now, of course, the variable pricing is generally presented in such a way as to potentially save customers money, even though in many cases that really just implies that the original price was more than needed to make a reasonable profit, or with prices on other items set high enough to make up for the lower price of a loss leader product. On top of media reports mostly being indifferent to the potential change, Coca-Cola stockholders were reportedly initially very happy to hear that the company had developed technology that would squeeze as much profit out of customers as possible. As stock analyst Bill Pecorelio noted, vending machines are already the most profitable channel for the beverage companies, so any effort to get higher profits when demand is higher obviously can enhance the profitability of the system further. A company spokesman called Rob Raskin, later quizzed on the matter, seemed excited about the potential that the idea had. In fact, Baskins revealed that at the time the story broke, variable pricing in vending machines was something the Coca-Cola company had been looking at for more than a year. Additionally, although Baskins claims that Coca-Cola hadn't yet trialed the technology in the real world, it would appear that preliminary tests of vending machines that adjusted the price of their contents in relation to the overall temperature had been conducted in Japan by the company. It's unclear what the results of these tests were, but given that Coca-Cola seemed happy to charge ahead with the plan, it's safe to say that the results must have been promising. The problem was that while customers are generally happy to accept variable pricing with little complaint in many instances, even often with drinks at bars and the like, most companies who do this don't blatantly broadcast to the customers that the main purpose of the variable pricing is to squeeze every dime possible out of said consumers. Instead, these sorts of variable pricing schemes are generally presented as a benefit to the customers, even though the underlying goal is always to maximize profits. For example, hotels don't advertise that they raise prices during peak times, they instead pitch it as lowering them in the off-season. Or as David Leonhard of the New York Times notes of supermarket variable pricing, "The supermarkets used sales on those goods to bring customers in their doors. They made the bulk of their profit from the other items the people bought while in the store. So even if the final bill was the same as it would have been if the beer had been marked up, shoppers could walk out with both the items they wanted and the sense that they were treated fairly." But with Coca-Cola's CEO being so unabashedly blatant that the purpose of the variable pricing was to maximize profits by milking the customers for all they were worth and not spinning it as a benefit to anyone but Coca-Cola stockholders, unsurprisingly, public outrage over the plan did not take long to manifest. Furious Coke drinkers complained to Coca-Cola in droves, and the media, always keen on a bit of outrage for its ability to get eyeballs watching and reading the news, decided to stoke the flames of the controversy by reaching out to Pepsi for comment. Naturally, while no doubt privately kicking themselves that they had not thought of it first, Pepsi publicly released many a scathing statement condemning Coca-Cola's avaricious attempts to nickel and dime their customers. For example, Pepsi spokesman Jeff Brown stated, "We believe that machines that raise prices in hot weather exploit consumers who live in warm climates. At Pepsi, we are focused on innovations that make it easier for consumers to buy a soft drink, not harder." Pepsi's sentiments were echoed by other competitors in the beverage industry, with one unnamed executive being quoted as scoffing, "What's next? A machine that x-rays people's pockets to find out how much change they have and raises the price accordingly?" Interestingly enough, in many industries, how wealthy a person appears or what the wealth demographics of an area are often make a difference on what price products or services are listed at. In the early 2000s, there were even rumors, though they denied it, that Amazon was using such demographic data to dynamically adjust prices for a given consumer. The real damage to Coca-Cola, though, that came from the bottlers the company so depended on. Also, bear in mind that these people, they were also pretty upset with Ivester over things like raising the price on the concentrate used for making the drinks, with one unnamed bottling executive graphically stating Coca-Cola was raping the bottlers. So why would they be unhappy about this particular snafu? Well, for that, you need to look no further than the largest, and that would be CCE. After the media backlash from this and other foibles under Ivester, they watched in horror as their stock price nosedived from $37 to $18 per share in only about 5 months. Rather unsurprisingly, Coca-Cola would very soon disavow their CEO's comments on these variably priced vending machines. The aforementioned Coca-Cola spokesman, Rob Baskin, with his PR cap no doubt spinning fast enough to create a tornado during the interview, now denied that the company had ever seriously planned to utilize the technology. You know, that is despite the fact that he said Coca-Cola had been exploring these machines for the better part of a year, and that the company had already trialed them in Japan and were very excited about the prospects in the United States. Baskin then decided to intelligently explain the variable pricing, now doing it the way pretty much every other industry who uses variable pricing does it. He noted that if Coca-Cola ever did decide to introduce variable pricing vending machines, the company would almost certainly use them to lower the price of its soda at off-peak times. No doubt quietly raising the normal price until the lowered price matched the original price, assuming the potential increase in sales wasn't enough to, at minimum, cover the loss from lowering the price. Well, in the end, the public were woefully unimpressed with Coca-Cola's sputtering explanation, and the company's stock price took a notable hit following the sustained negative coverage of their little scheme. Incidentally, Ivester only lasted about 2 years as CEO before he decided to retire after a private meeting with Warren Buffett and Herbert Allen, two of the largest stockholders in the company. The rumor was that they politely told him to either step down as CEO voluntarily, or they'd see to it that his removal happened anyway. Whatever was actually said, almost immediately after the meeting, he very suddenly announced his retirement. for his amazing work at Coca-Cola. He was awarded a retirement package of about $166 million, which is about $240 million today. So as I mentioned at the start of the video, if you like this channel, you'll probably like Cheddar's videos as well. They're making weekly YouTube videos, and one of the ones they recently made is kind of related to this topic, because, you know, flexible prices on a vending machine, kind of like an old school way to rip people off, but another way the companies kind of sneakily charge you for extra stuff is in applications or video games, you know, where it's like, hey, buy an extra life, or buy some in-game money or some points. Basically, the whole pay-to-win thing. And it's worth an insane amount of money, which they talk about in this video. And you also probably don't know how it started. It all got started with decorative horse armor. Yeah, I'm not kidding. And I'm just gonna end today's video by playing you a bit of that video from Cheddar. And if you wanna see the rest of it, please do click the link in the description below. And if you do like their video, do subscribe to their channel. They've got loads of other great stuff like that. And thank you to Cheddar for sponsoring this video, and over to them.
Candy Crush Saga by King is the most downloaded game app of all time. And they make a killing selling you new lives, extra moves, and new levels. A major part of their $1.5 billion annual revenue. On one hand, free-to-play apps allow people from all economic backgrounds to download and play a version of the game. But on the other hand, spending becomes more necessary and more enticing the further along a player gets.